Hello, I'm Alex and welcome to the History Chronicles. If you like our work, then please don't forget to like and subscribe. And if you'd like to support the channel in return for exclusive perks, please visit our Patreon page. Now, on with the video. Why was there slavery in the Barbary states? And who was behind it? Let's find out in today's episode of the History Chronicles. Today's History Chronicle begins on the 20th of June 1631 in the small coastal town of Baltimore in Southern Ireland. On that day, several ships descended on the town, and in the hours that followed, the settlement was sacked and somewhere between 150 and 230 of its inhabitants were taken off as prisoners. One would think at first that England, which ruled Ireland at the time, was at war, perhaps with its perennial enemy during the 16th and early 17th century, Spain, and that this was a raid by the Spanish Navy. But this was not the case. No, these ships had come all the way from North Africa, and they were manned by pirates from the Barbary coast on a slave raiding mission. The roughly 200 prisoners who were taken from Baltimore in the summer of 1631 were carried off to North Africa. And although a handful of the more wealthy individuals were soon released upon payment of a hefty ransom by their families and associates in Ireland, the bulk of those who were captured were doomed to live out the rest of their days as slaves of the Barbary pirates and the Barbary states of North Africa. Many of them press-ganged into serving as rowers on board galleys in the Mediterranean Sea. So just who and what were these Barbary pirates and the Barbary states which supported them? And what was life like for the people they enslaved during the early modern period? The term Barbary is derived from the word Berber, the name of the people who generally dominated the western parts of the Maghreb from ancient times, covering much of the region from Morocco, east as far as Libya, and south towards Mali and Niger. Thus, the Barbary coast refers to the region approximately between western Morocco and modern-day Libya. When the Arab world broke up into individual states in the High Middle Ages, these countries became a series of independent kingdoms and sultanates. But in the course of the 16th century, the region gradually came under the dominance of the Ottoman Empire, ruled from Istanbul, and this led to the environment in which the Barbary pirates emerged. Just as the Ottoman Empire was coming to dominate the entirety of North Africa, it was also engaging in a titanic struggle with Spain and the Italian city-states for control over the Mediterranean Sea. This would often take the shape of the Ottoman fleet engaging the Christian powers' naval forces. But the sultans in Istanbul but also subcontract some of this work by allowing pirate fleets to operate out of the ports of the Barbary coast between Morocco and Tripoli. And these pirate fleets were given free rein to use the ports of North Africa as their bases and to strike at any and all Christian targets. Ports like Baltimore were used, and the lucrative Spanish ships traveling between Europe and the Americas were their targets. By the early 17th century, these Barbary pirates controlled hundreds of ships, employing tens of thousands of corsairs or pirates. They ranged far and wide, attacking as far north as Ireland. Moreover, they had extensive connections with European pirates, particularly British and Dutch buccaneers, which allowed them to gather information on potential targets in the northern Atlantic. For instance, the attack on Baltimore was actually led by a Dutch pirate, Jan Zoon van Haarlem, an individual who had converted to Islam and become a pirate captain himself, better known as Rees Murad. Similarly, European pirates would often travel to the Barbary coast to sell their stolen goods and replenish their supplies. These pirates engaged in what they did for many reasons. Firstly, there was very lucrative shipping to be found in both the Mediterranean and the Atlantic. For instance, Portuguese ships returning from India and the East Indies carried vast riches in spices from Asia, while the Spanish shipped enormous amounts of gold and silver bullion from the New World back to Spain every year during the 16th and 17th centuries. But while great profits could accrue from attacking and seizing merchant ships, the primary objective of Barbary piracy was to capture slaves to be brought back to North Africa or traded further east in the Mediterranean, to the major cities of Istanbul, Cairo, and Damascus. We might ask how extensive this slave trade was. One of the leading studies of the Barbary slave trade estimates that there were between 1 million and 1.25 million Europeans or peoples of European descent from the Americas enslaved by the Barbary pirates. Between the inception of the practice in around 1550 and its termination in around 1830. This figure has been reached by estimating that approximately 8,500 people were enslaved by the Barbary pirates each year for roughly a 250-year period. And this figure does seem plausible when we consider that just one pirate raid on the island of Gozo near Malta in 1551 saw as many as 6,000 people carried off as slaves. As we have seen, the upper limit of the number of Europeans captured by the Barbary pirates was about 1.25 million. However, between 1550 and 1850, the European powers and the United States actively captured or purchased over 12 million Africans in Western Africa and transported them to the New World to work as slaves on tobacco, cotton, and sugar plantations. Moreover, this trade extended into the Mediterranean Sea, and the southern European powers such as Spain, Venice, and Genoa used Muslim slaves themselves to row their own galleys. A significant proportion of those who were enslaved by the Barbary pirates and their allies were able to gain their freedom if they had significant connections back in Europe and wealthy friends or were rich themselves. It made far greater sense for the corsairs to release them and send them back to Europe in exchange for a hefty ransom. Others were simply able to find an opportune moment to escape. It has consequently been estimated by one study that as many as one quarter of all the British people who were enslaved by the Barbary pirates during the early 17th century were able to gain their freedom within a few years. The key was for the ransom to be higher than the amount the slave could be sold for. In the Muslim world, the European slaves could marry with their owner's permission, and they could also own property. Indeed, they could even set up their own businesses, ones which often catered for other European slaves, such as taverns or eateries which sold European food, although a significant proportion of the profits were given to the slave owner. Eventually, if such a business was successful, the slave could even buy his or her own freedom with the profits. It should be clear from all this that European slaves in North Africa and in the lands of the Ottoman Empire further east were treated much more favourably than their African counterparts were by their European masters in the Americas. And in assessing the fate of those Europeans who were enslaved by the Barbary pirates between the 16th and 19th centuries, we might say that they were treated much as slaves were in ancient Greece and Rome, as a functioning lower class of society, whereas African slaves in the New World by the 18th century were treated in a far more brutal fashion. Exactly what these European slaves might find themselves doing in their new lives as slaves was dependent on their sex, their physical properties, and where in the Muslim world they eventually ended up once they were sold off by their captors. Such a move could bring with it considerable influence, and there are no shortage of stories of European women rising to powerful positions within the imperial palace and the empire as a whole, as a result of having wiled their way into the Sultan's inner circle. Younger men who were strong might suffer press-ganging into the galley fleets of the Mediterranean. The extent of these fleets can be seen from the famous Battle of Lepanto, which occurred between the Ottoman Empire and her allies on the one hand, and Spain and its allies amongst the Italian city-states and the papacy on the other. This was fought on the 7th of October 1571 in the Gulf of Patras in the Ionian Sea off of western Greece. Over 220 Ottoman galleys were employed in this battle, rowed by 37,000 oarsmen, many of whom would have been European slaves. When we consider the scale of this, it is not difficult to imagine how many European males must have served as slaves in the Ottoman galleys over the years. Many other slaves would have led more sedentary and mundane lives in the cities of North Africa and the Eastern Mediterranean. Those who were well educated might have risen to positions of some prominence, facilitating trade in cities like Cairo. For instance, if they could read and write, they could facilitate trade with European merchants, while if they could speak several European languages, they would be greatly prized as somebody who could facilitate communications in metropolitan cities such as Istanbul, Cairo, or Damascus. In these instances, a slave from Europe might be able to carve out a relatively decent life, despite their bondage. It is perhaps unsurprising to learn that many European slaves in the Barbary states turned native, as it were. This could involve converting to Islam and perhaps marrying a Muslim woman. For instance, Jan Janszoon, the man who became Rees Mourad and led the attack on Baltimore in 1631, had himself been captured by Algerian pirates while sailing off the coast of Lanzarote in the Canary Islands in 1618. He subsequently converted and flourished as a Barbary pirate himself. He was one of thousands of European captives who Islamized in this fashion. The phenomenon of piracy on the Barbary coast lasted a surprisingly long time. European piratical activity peaked in the late 17th and early 18th century in the Western Atlantic, the so-called Golden Age of Piracy, but it was then rapidly clamped down on by the European powers in the 1720s and 1730s. However, the Barbary pirates survived for much longer, in large part because they could always find safe havens in North Africa, despite periods during which the Ottoman sultans in Istanbul tried to reduce their activities as the Ottoman Empire itself speedily weakened and lost territory during the course of the 18th century. The end came right at the beginning of the 19th century, As soon as it had gained independence from Britain, the United States began experiencing attacks on its shipping in the Atlantic by Barbary pirates. In two wars, America's first ever seas wars, between 1801 and 1805, and again in 1815, the US attacked the North African states in response to its harbouring of pirates. This reduced their activity, which was then fully brought to an end from 1830 onwards, when France invaded and colonised Algeria, the main hub of the Barbary pirates in the early 19th century. Thus ended the scourge of Barbary piracy, which had plagued Europe and the Atlantic for over 250 years. More recently, the horrors of the trading of slaves has come to prominence in the public eye, and rightly so, as history unremembered is a lesson unlearned. However, it must also be remembered that slavery has been a universal constant since the dawn of human civilization, and that every race has both suffered and perpetrated slavery on others at some point in human history. You have been watching the History Chronicles. We'd love to know what you think of slavery in the Barbary States. Please let us know below, and if you enjoyed our video, please give us a like and subscribe. It really helps us out. Also, if you'd like to support our work going forward, please visit our Patreon page, and we look forward to seeing you again on the next episode of the History Chronicles.